I don't even know who is going to be the number one pick. If you put a gun to my head right now and said name five college basketball players, I'd be like, just pull the trigger.
No one cared about women's basketball till literally last year.
And guess what's going to happen? I bet the Pistons get the number one pick this year.
Has the craziest fandom, like the most extreme escapism ever.
I couldn't tell you how many 40 and 50 year olds I saw carrying belts.
In front of everyone was like, you're fired. Get the fuck out of here.
Welcome to The Real Oshow. I'm Zachary.
And I'm Joshua. And we're brothers chasing the curiosity of our life.
And on this show, we'll deep dive the most influential people, music, and topics going on in the world.
And today we talk about why the WWE wins, March Madness, and why men's college basketball has a systematic problem. I got a stack of this gold. I tell you I'm on a roll. About to get all this dough. Me and no fuck niggas know. I swear to God we the ghosts. This ain't the story they told. Man, if you know, then you know. I never had to tell my dogs when we on roof for breaks. They pay for getters, they want money more.
I was on the subway the other day, Joshua, and you know, obviously New York subways have their own rep. They're grimy, no doubt. You know, it's for poor people. But you know, I was on the subway the other day, and you see a lot of shit in New York, and this is like the first time I've ever seen something like this. There was a blind guy, right? And you know, that happens in New York, but he was asking for money, and he had money in his cup.
How do we know this guy was blind?
Bro, he had no eyes, bro. You could easily tell. All like you, right, like they were cut out.
I didn't know if he had like glasses on or something.
No. Like it was like, it was real deal.
Okay.
And he had a cup with like $5 probably in it, like all ones. And before he asked anybody for money, he reached into the cup, pulled the $5 out, put it in his pocket, and then proceeded to start asking people with just the coins in the cup for money. And I was like, A, like respect. But, like, we all saw that. Like, I don't know if you can't see it, but we saw it.
Yeah, dude. Homeless people in New York are the fucking worst. They're the worst humans on earth. It's not even close. And I'm not trying to be a scumbag or, like, talk down. These are the worst humans on earth. The worst. They're the ones you, like, give a dollar and they'll, like, roll your eyes at you and be like, wow, you should have gave more. And it's like, who the fuck are you? Who the fuck? You can't even give them food. A lot of times you try to give them food and they're just like, pfft. Like that, it's like, what? Bro, you're fucking pissing yourself on the street. I try to give you food and you're like talking down to me.
Yeah, it's wild.
Like, it's wild. It's like, it's a, this perceived notion in their head that they just like they deserve it. I have no idea. I mean, listen, what hustling 101 is make them feel bad for you. And he's like, oh, I got nothing in the cup. I mean, that's what they all do.
The fact is everybody saw it.
But imagine if you fucking had a cup that had a bunch of fucking money in it. Would it make you feel inclined to donate? Hell no. I'd be like, go fucking pick your ass up and go do something else.
So as we transition, Joshua, you brought up WWE, which I think is a great jumping off point to the bones of this episode.
Yeah.
WWE fucking wins. They win at marketing, at views, at getting people to show up to events, and everybody knows it's scripted. Everybody knows it's fake. Yet people are still like on the edge of their seat about something. And then I really want to pull on WrestleMania because that just happened. And that's like the Super Bowl of WWE, if you didn't know. And what I thought was fascinating, obviously they brought The Rock back to be a huge centerpiece of WWE. Obviously he has some equity or whatever. But what was great about WrestleMania, they bring The Undertaker back. John Cena comes back. Randy Orton RKOs Oshow Speed, one of the biggest streamers in the world, in a prime bottle. Logan Paul's a fucking marketing genius. And then they also have Logan Paul, one of the biggest influencers in the world, on their team. Like, the way they go about their business is something that I think every business, or really like entertainment industry, should literally try to replicate, but they can't.
Let's break down everything you just said, because I think you said a lot there to digest. One, wrestling is real. I would say it's real. It is scripted. It has an idea. Like they have a story that they're trying to depict, but what those guys do is incredible. And if you think it's fake, it is not fake. These guys legit.
No, they
these guys
really
are like,
get hurt. They really get hurt.
I'm not saying like, oh, it's fucking real. Like they're no, it's like it's not like a UFC fight, right?
Yeah.
It's not, like that's where I'm saying it's like they're scripting this story. And I was telling Zachary, I was like, the WWE has the craziest fandom. Like we were at WrestleMania this week, and we didn't actually attend the event, but we were at WWE World. That place has the craziest fandom, like the most extreme escapism ever. but it's because these guys are showmen. It's like Broadway meets fucking very, very, very intense sports. The storylines are crazy. Vince McMahon has took over why the WWF, WWE is so big. And obviously The Rock playing a big part of it. Obviously TKO Sports owned WWE. They bought the UFC. It's like now the holding company. They gave Rock equity because to be on the board. So he's basically, you know, a shareholder of this company. They gave him the rights to his name, which if you didn't know, the WWE owns everyone's name.
They own everything.
They own everything. The biggest actors, a lot of them are from the WWE, male and female. This WrestleMania was probably the greatest WrestleMania ever. And I'm not even saying that from like a casual, like we're not even really fans. Like we liked Logan Paul. I liked The Rock. Like I couldn't even tell you who's on the active roster. Like I didn't really even know Cody Rhodes' story until like this fucking weekend.
I only know the OGs.
And let me tell you something. Shout out to Cody Rhodes. Cause like you actually watched that guy's story, bro. I watched this TikTok doc on it. Wow. Congrats to that dude. Like pretty wild. Like you should
like
do some
hard life.
No, well, his dad was Dusty Rhodes, like the famous wrestler, right?
No idea.
He's like a very famous, before our time, and very famous wrestler, and he passed away. But so Cody was trying to like build this character, and he went in there because his dad, name, right? But then Vince McMahon basically was like, in front of everyone, was like, you're fired. Get the fuck out of here. Like in front of the whole stadium was like, you're fired. So then he had to go to TNT and like reinvent himself. And then he had reinvented himself as like the American like nightmare. Like that was his thing. Got like this like tattoo on his neck. And then they finally, he was a superstar in TNT. Then they brought him back. And instead of like building a new character for him, they just let him be his own thing. Normally when they bring a guy from like TNT, they reinvent him to be like this new thing. They were like, no, play that character. And so then as he played his character, it was like this full circle moment that now he's a champion. So it was pretty cool. Like where he literally got kicked off. And like a lot of the things were like, this is scripted. Like that was his life. Like he actually got kicked off. He actually had to those were all real things.
They're still real humans. No, and they're really throwing people through tables and people get hurt and accidents
the
happen.
The Drewski clip, he was like, oh, you can't make that up. Like he was sitting green. So he's like, bro, that's real as fuck.
Yeah.
It's like,
I saw that.
You know, KSI was FaceTiming Oshow Speed because Oshow Speed got RKO'd, like you said. And KSI was like, haha, it sucks, doesn't it? Because KSI got RKO'd and then got Prime dumped on him. And it's like, bro, sometimes you just got to be the dummy. And it's like, it's still going to hurt. But it's like, it's for showmen and like, it's electric. Like you see these guys, like these guys had a football stadium, 80,000 people screaming their name. Like, bro, the adrenaline that you would have, like, and it's like a lot of the stuff, it's like they are kind of just like feeding off each other. It's not like they're like, oh, I'm gonna do this or I'm doing this. Maybe they have like one or two things they're planned, but it's like, man, for the most part, it's like these guys are just
they're definitely leaning into the crowd, like based on kind of what that's going. I mean, it's what the NFL does,
but the WWE stays so relevant because they're bringing back stars like the Logan Pauls, then they bring in like the KSIs, now you're bringing in the Oshow Speeds, you're bringing in a whole different demographic that, like,
WWE
doesn't like it. And it's like, I'll be honest with you, the WWE demographic ain't just white people.
Yeah.
It is every color, religion, everything. Like, I'm not kidding. I talk to people from every forms of life, bro. People were coming to Philadelphia to be there.
It's definitely an older demo.
It is an older demo.
Bro, we were in the WrestleMania Superstore, and I couldn't tell you how many 40 and 50-year-olds I saw carrying belts.
There, like
me and Joshua were doing that shit at 10 years old.
It's that as well. I think it's both sides. I think to go to like a WWE world, like I think that's like a, you kind of are a little probably older doing those things. Like I saw some families doing that, but I agree. I think it is an older demographic. That's why you have to bring in these streamers. Like you saw Kai Cenat was doing like his own little like WrestleMania in his room when he was doing like the Red Deb stream where he did like 40 hours straight or whatever. They did like a little like wrestling in his room. And I'm like, but that is like the core. Like if you're like a little boy, you want to fucking watch wrestling.
Yeah.
Like that's like, it's like, that's the coolest
thing.
I used
to love it as a kid.
No, it's the coolest thing as a kid.
And like, and I could go to WrestleMania. What I thought was the coolest thing is I have not watched a fucking wrestling match, maybe like a clip here and there in 12 years. And I went to WrestleMania and then knew majority of the people there. because they were pulling from my time. John Cena, Undertaker, Randy Orton.
But that's also
Triple
good
branding. H.
That's good branding. Well, Triple H is now kind of
like
he's
the
Vince
CEO.
McMahon.
He's
he's
CEO, but like he was the guy back in the day.
Yeah, Triple H, Shawn Michaels, like all the guys, like, right? Like those are very, but they're just so good at branding. They are
it
like
is
when,
branded.
When you say it, like I don't like to use the word superstar lightly. Like when I talk about like basketball, there's five superstars in all of NBA. Yeah. There's five.
Five to seven. We could sit here and debate.
We could, but I would debate that the only thing that makes you a superstar in like the sport of basketball is like you won a championship, like legit, like you. And when I say that, it's like Curry's, the LeBrons, the Giannis, the Kawhi Leonard's, maybe one more out of that. Like they have like
Kevin Durant.
That's it. Like anything else, like Tatum, all star. He's a great guy, but he's never fucking willed. Exactly. That's my point. Yeah. Embiid, not a superstar.
But I wouldn't call those guys.
Jokic,
superstars.
Maybe. I'd maybe say Jokic.
Jokic
is
a
superstar. So that's six. So
I said five to seven.
Okay, maybe. But you could. But I'm saying very limited. Yeah. But in the WWE, I can legitimately be like, dude, those guys are all superstars because like they, the way that they command it, like dude, they do more shows than an NBA. They do more like. And they sell out crowds every fuck all over the world. Yeah. It's nuts.
Do they still do like the weekly shows like Monday Night Raw and Friday Night SmackDown? All
that? Yes. And those guys are doing that weekly, 52 weeks a year. Like that's
but
nuts.
They're not all fighting like a week over a week.
No, though. But it's quite a bit. And it's like if you're not, you're still out there doing promos and you're still like you're still traveling. It's a hassle.
Yeah, and then they do the pay-per-view shows. I mean, it's a real hard life.
Bro, they do like a pay-per-view a month.
Yeah, I mean, it's a hard life. It's a hard
but
life.
But it's it's they get paid very well and you're going to be a movie star most likely after.
Yeah. I mean, the WWE owns everything, but the only thing they can't take from you is that your face recognition.
Yeah. Basketball's so big, it's because the face recognition. Yeah. Which I think leads us into the next topic, which is March Madness.
March Madness just finished up. And I've just had this in my head where I never watch college basketball ever until March Madness comes back around. And then I watch these games with players I have no idea. Of course, I know some of the, like, the teams because like the branding. But I can sit there and watch every single game and be like, this is great.
Can I be honest with you? I think that March Madness is such a genius idea. It's probably the most genius marketing idea when you get every corporate company in the world does something around March Madness, which is insane to me. But college basketball can consistently put a bad product out, like a bad product.
Yeah.
Like a bad product.
College basketball is the worst. It's terrible.
It's horrible. And it's like, to me, they can put out a bad product and they're still like, everyone will still consume it.
March Madness isn't a bad product, though. It's not.
March Madness isn't a bad product.
But that's the
point. Men's college basketball is a bad product.
The regular season is a bad product.
But I even watch, and again, this tournament this year was not that exciting. Like, I'll be honest with you, UConn beating every team by 30 points. UConn was impressive, perhaps. Beating every team by 30 points, is that really a good tournament? Like, do you know what I'm saying? They had the largest margin of victory ever in the history.
I mean, it was
of
one of the most impressive things that has happened in men's basketball. 100%,
but it's not a good product as a whole, and that's what I'm trying to say. And I think the NLI will actually help college basketball because it allows players to like build a brand, and that's why women's college basketball has won, because we've had Caitlin Clark for 4 years. We've had Angel Reese for fucking 4 years. We've had insert a lot of other women's basketball players that are studs that, again, not to take credit away, you know, discredit away from everyone else who came before them, but there was no brand. No one cared about women's basketball till literally last year.
The thing, when we talked about this, women's college basketball, like the women are more skilled than the men in college. Then obviously they go to the NBA and then it's just like, you're talking multiple planets away from each other. But
look at college basketball, though. The number one player the last 2 years, Zach Edey, they're like, he might be a first-round pick. Think about that. The AP number one player.
He's been 6 years in college
basketball. It does not matter, Zachary. Look at any other sport. The number one player in college football, He's like the number one pick. The number one pick in hockey, number one player in hockey, the number one pick. The number one player in baseball would be the number one pick. Like all of it's every sport unanimously, Zachary.
I mean, they're also saying this is possibly the worst NBA draft ever.
But that it does not. And that says even more.
And guess what's going to happen? I bet the Pistons get the number one pick this year.
Exactly.
Because it doesn't matter.
I'm telling you right now, there's a systematic problem with college men's college basketball. If the number one player consistently, Zachary, they were saying that Zach Edey will probably not play in the NBA. Think about that. The number one player in college basketball. I'm just like, you can shrug all you want. I'm saying that is a systematic problem. No other college sport. Zachary, who's the number one player in college women's basketball? Caitlin Clark. Guess what? And this is another tangent I want to talk to. Indianapolis. Wow, their city's going up. The number one player in college sports should be a very high sought after pick in the next level. And that is a fact. That's a fact. Or they shouldn't be fucking voted that. But to be unanimously, it's not even close. The last 2 years, Zach Edey has been it. Like, they haven't even said another person's name. They're like, it's Zach Edey unanimously. The guy had 38 points in the fucking national championship game. He even talked about, he's like, bro, I can shoot. It's just not part of the system. And people still are like, nah. Don't think he's got it. So it's like, to me, I'm like, that's a systematic problem.
I mean, I don't even know who is going to be the number one pick. If you put a gun to my head right now and said name five college basketball players, I'd be like, just pull the trigger.
That's how bad the branding is, though. And that's another thing. If you like, that's why, again, I hope NLI helps us out, but it will hold guys a little bit longer. Like, dude, if you're not marketing yourself on Instagram, like building a brand, if you're like going to be a top pick, like you're a one and done guy, if you're not using that 1 year to like really build a brand at college, then you are fucking slat. Like you can't, like it sounds crazy. Like if you're a hooper, like you want to be a hooper, but at some point it's like, you only have sports for a limited time. You have to take advantage. It's just a fact.
I think in like the team's eyes, and this is more so speaking about all sports, obviously, once you prove yourself in the NBA, you can kind of build that brand, as you can see, because the stars, the superstars can
for sure
literally do whatever they want. But I think going into the draft process, and this is all sports, those people who are very out there on social media, I think the teams push them down.
For sure. But like, unless you're Victor Wembanyama, you get stuck in a place like San Antonio. No one's ever going to hear of you again.
No,
you,
stop.
Zachary.
Stop. Zachary. The NBA won't let that happen. The NBA Zachary. Wants him to be the next Tim Duncan.
I said unless your name is Victor Wembanyama.
Oh, you're saying if you're just like a John Doe.
Yes, you're a John Doe, but you're a good player, and you go to San Antonio and you don't have this big brand, you're just gonna be fucking John Doe. You're never gonna be like, no one's ever gonna be like, who? You know what I mean? You're in year eight, and that's just what it is. But I do want to say this because I think it's cool. I think this is a good thing to end on. Indianapolis, it's going up. Obviously, our brother is working for Indiana University, but Caitlin Clark is projected to be the number one pick in the WNBA, obviously. And everyone's just assuming she's just going to go to the WNBA.
I still don't think it's for sure.
I don't think so either, but it's like everyone's assuming that, which makes me think like, oh, I don't know. But it's good for us because obviously we're going to be going to Indiana a lot. So Indianapolis is supposed to be the team. They are the team with number one pick. So
what's their mascot?
I have no fucking clue what their mascot is, bro.
The Fever, maybe?
I don't know. I don't know what the team is called, but once Caitlin Clark joins the squad, I bet you all know what the team is called.
Yeah.
And that's my point. I'm not going to know. I know the only team that I know is the Phoenix Mercury.
Yeah.
Only because of the guy who owns the team. That I'm blanking on his name right now.
Ishba,
Michigan guy.
Who's getting sued right now as we speak and might have to sell the Suns, but yeah.
Yeah.
Did you hear about that?
No, I mean, I'm not saying he's a great guy.
He's getting investigated for intentionally like raising the interest rates on mortgages to individuals.
He 100% did that.
Yeah.
Listen, 100%. If you don't think that big fucking people are doing that, like he's probably not the only one. I mean, actually, I think I saw that he has like 70% of all mortgages ever.
Him and Dan Gilbert of Rocket Mortgage, who
they definitely did that.
Inside story, hate each other. Actually, like legit hate each other. Obviously, because they play in the same market, went to the same school, a lot of you know, issues that way. But yeah, like, and then Ishba's being like, fucking Dan Gilbert wrote that goddamn article, and like all that, like, has been like pushing it, which probably is.
Maybe.
But obviously there's something there, but the reason why it's kind of like, cause, it was Joe Pomp who was talking about it. He was like, you know, I was talking to people in like the financial industry, and every single person he asked about, they're like, yeah, oh yeah, he's definitely doing that, because 100%. Because the way they do, and I can't think, I'm blanking
they're
on their company.
They're bullying all the smaller people. Well,
yes, they're bullying all the small people, but the benefit with working with them or Rocket Mortgage is you get a mortgage like quick. Instead of going to your local credit union, that's going to take time, process, it's a lot slower. So that's kind of their thing, is like, you're going to pay more, but you're going to get it done quicker. Like, that's kind of their thing. But now I don't know why they're getting attacked.
Bro.
And now he might have to sell the team.
I actually, now that you say that, I do remember the story a little bit. I remember reading about it. They're literally just bullying all these people I remember reading the story. And again, this is all alleged, but I'm assuming this actually happened, because this is what big corporate companies do. They bully little guys they can.
Yeah.
They can get away with it. And guess what? Nothing will happen from this. He's not going to sell this team. Like, bro, there's nothing that's going to happen. This is just like a little to muddy the water a little bit. That's all this ever is.
Of course. But that's a good place to wrap up. Yeah. If you made it this far, drop a like, leave a comment, subscribe, share with somebody. We really appreciate it. 101st episode on the road to 200, and then 1,000 next. But we appreciate the love. Till next time.
See you guys. I got a plan for my bros. I got a stack of this gold. I tell you I'm on a roll. About to get all this dough. Me and no fuck niggas know. I swear to God, we the ghosts. This ain't the story they told. Man, if you know, then you know. I never had to tell my dogs, and we on roof of brains. They pay me.